My objective was the signs and symptoms of the acute MI with the EKG and labs involved. I also do a short presentation on the normal physiology, electrophysiology of the heart with the EKG. So before I get into it, I want to just point out that the myocardial infarction is a form of acute coronary syndrome, ACS, and the ACS has basically three subcategories. So you can have ST segment elevation myocardial infarction, you can have non-ST segment elevation myocardial infarction, and you can have unstable angina. Unstable angina is important because it can turn into a myocardial infarction, but for the purpose of this lecture, focus on the top two. What's that running across my screen? Oh look, it's an opossum, as indicated by the arrow. And that's my tribute. What you're going to have is your typical presentation or your chief complaint. You can either have chest pain or not chest pain. So we're going to take a look at chest pain first. If a person comes in complaining about chest pain, you're going to want to have myocardial infarction on your list automatically. Now, what are some things that can rule it down? Well, the location, if the location tends to be local, then it's probably chest wall or pleural in nature, or it could be pulmonary. However, this can't rule out an MI, it just rules it down. If it's regional pain, it tends to rule up a myocardial infarction. There was an interesting study done where 202 patients were evaluated for chest pain, and out of those, the ones that would place the palm over the center of their chest had low predictive value for myocardial infarction. So the classical presentation that you see in a lot of pictures of an MI, it has a very low predictive value. It doesn't mean it's not an MI, it just means that you can't really say, oh, hand over chest, that must be an MI. It probably isn't. Eight patients used their finger to point to a spot on their chest, and only one of those eight were presented with an MI. And then the patients that presented with large areas of pain had a stronger association for having an MI. So you might notice that I'm kind of going through the acronym SICOR AAA, which is basically your history of present illness questions. I'm not doing them in the exact same order, but you'll notice that radiation is next on my list. The classical presentation for myocardial infarction is radiation to the left arm. While it is an indicator of an MI, it has lower predictive value than radiation to the right arm. And an infarction can have a lot of varied presentations. So you can have radiation to the neck, throat, lower jaw, teeth, upper extremity, shoulder, and those all are indicative of an MI. But you also have to consider other possible causes. So, for example, cholecystitis. This will present with upper quadrant pain, and it will also radiate to the shoulder. A chest pain radiating to the back between the scapula is indicative of an aortic dissection. So radiating pain, you have to distinguish where it's going to, and so those can be clues in your history. Now also, you want to check for the quality of pain. So like I said earlier, radiation to the right arm, it's got a strong likelihood ratio of being an MI. It can be anywhere between 1.9 and 12, but the 95% confidence interval puts it at 4.7. Radiation to both arms or shoulders, very strong likelihood ratio. If it's exertional, radiation to the left arm, these things are also indicative, but with lower likelihood ratios. If you have sweat, diaphoresis, or nausea and vomiting, or if a patient has a history of angina and that pain gets suddenly worse, then you can also say it's an, you know, let's look at it for an MI. If it's described as a pressure, so a tightness or a pressure in the chest, look for an MI. Things that have a lower likelihood value, pleuritic, positional, sharp, reproducible with palpation, you're probably looking at chest wall pain, so musculoskeletal. If the pain is described as sharp, you want to think about aortic dissection. And now, non-exertional, this is a big one, because MIs, whenever you have a case or if you're taking a test, you're gonna try to be thrown off, and someone's going to say, well, he didn't have any, he was sitting on his couch, and all of a sudden his chest hurt. And a a lot of times those things are going to be MIs on a test, but in an actual clinic, your likelihood ratio is 0.8. Now, something that's positional, if a person changes position and the pain either gets better or worse, then you want to think something like pericarditis. So then aggravating factors or provocations, just to ask, does it get better when better or worse when you eat? If it's worse when you eat, upper GI problems is a possible DDX, but it's also associated with severe myocardial ischemia. Exertion is a big one for MI, so angina and esophageal problems are things you want to look at for exertion. Ischemic pain is also associated with the cold, emotional stress, meals, and intercourse. So someone's having sex, they get a heart attack. It happens. And then for positional type of things, you want to think of these. So laying down, for example, would cause more pain with pneumonia, breathing in deeply, pulmonary pneumothorax. So, random joke to break up the monotony. So one thing you're going to ask is, what makes things better? Does an antacid make it better? That's one of the key questions that you can quickly rule down an MI and rule up a GI problem. Unfortunately, nitroglycerin, having relief from nitroglycerin, hasn't been extremely effective at specifying the cause of a problem. For example, if you have 35% of non-cardiac involvement chest pain, found relief with nitro, one of the main things is like an esophageal spasm. Nitro can help that. Another thing that's not very helpful is the GI cocktail. You can find relief from the GI cocktail with GI and cardiac problems. Now, if the pain is slightly relieved with the cessation of activity, that's strongly suggestive of ischemic origin. Now, while this not being present isn't going to rule out an MI, having this present will move MI up on your differential. Now, the onset, a pain that gradually increases over time, it's more so if it's a sudden onset, it's going to be one of these etiologies. If it's a gradual increase over time, typically one of these. Now that's a rule of thumb and it's supported by statistics, but it's not definitive. Now the associated symptoms. So I have the study guide posted on Box. There's a lot more than just this, but these are the ones that I could find numbers for. So in a study of 515 women with an acute myocardial infarction, these are the numbers. Most of the highest number presented with chest pain and shortness of breath. Right after that would be weakness, fatigue, and chest discomfort. I don't really like this word chest discomfort because what does that mean? I don't know. Does it mean that you have chest pain, you just don't want to complain about it too much? I don't know. Now, a woman with chest pain comes in. One thing that you want to move up on your differential is abuse. And it's also important to know that a man is more likely to complain of chest pain when he has a heart attack than a woman is. So women typically will present more often with no chest pain and they'll still have an MI. Which leads right into the next part of this presentation. So you can have patients with an MI present with no chest pain. And when they do that, the typical symptoms you're going to see will be one or any combination of these. So dyspnea, nausea and vomiting, palpitations, syncope, cardiac arrest. And like I just said, patients that present with the atypical presentation are more likely to be women and older and diabetic. The big key, if there's no chest pain, the big key is you want to make a timely diagnosis because that's the main problem. If there's no chest pain, myocardial infarction usually doesn't get diagnosed in a timely manner. And just for that reason, I'm going to present you with a mnemonic for no chest pain myocardial infarction, which is going to be SNAP. Oh, let me make that an N. SNAP. D. Syncope, nausea, arrest, palpitations, and dyspnea. So let's think really quick what some of the differential would be other than myocardial infarction that you'd want to rule out. And you might I say you want to rule it out quickly. With dyspnea, you want to rule out primarily pulmonary causes. With nausea and vomiting, you're thinking GI, you're thinking DKA, and pancreatitis. So you could also be thinking food poison, toxins, those kind of things, but that would be associated with GI. With palpitations, you're probably thinking of other heart etiologies, so such as like AFib. And AFib can be a precursor for an MI, so just keep that in mind. But also on the differential for palpitations would be something like a pulmonary embolism. Now syncope with chest pain, so what should be on your differential? If you don't have chest pain, if you do have chest pain, you want to think aortic dissection, aortic aneurysm, pulmonary embolism. And without chest pain, I think you could still keep PE on there, but it's not as likely. So syncope, you would want to rule out other causes like a failure to oxygenate the blood or an anemia. So in your physical physical exam, you're going to do the typical IPPA, and on that, mostly what you're going to be doing is trying to rule out other causes of the symptoms. So he has dyspnea, but no chest pain. Probably going to be pulmonary or something related to like pneumonia rather than an MI, but you got to think, let me rule that up or down when you're doing your physical exam. So you did your physical exam, the next thing you're going to do is you're going to hook up an EKG and you're going to get some biomarkers. So like you're going to take the troponin I, troponin T, CKMB. So why do you get an ST elevation with a transmural infarction? Now I'll try to explain that is because this infarcted area is going to leak out some of the ions. So if I can just redraw this, this is the infarcted area right here. So the cells in the middle, they're leaking out ions in every direction, But the cells over here on the edge, they can only leak out ions in this direction. And then over here on the on this edge, of course, they're going to be leaking out this direction, but it's further away from your lead. So if your lead's over here, this is further away from your lead than this is, so it's going to these leaks are going to give a stronger indication on the lead than say these over here. And so what I'm going to do, I'm going to draw your EKG. So your normal EKG, you're going to have your P, your QRS, and then your T wave. Now if you're leaking stuff out, you're actually going to lower your base. So your P wave here, QRS. And then right here would be your normal, if you trace it over, your normal base. And this is where you're going to get this ST elevation. And so the at this segment up here is going to get repolarized to normal. And then they're going to slowly start leaking out some of the positive cations, making it much more negative. And that's why it looks like it's an elevation. It looks like ST is elevated, but really everything else is just lower. So we call this ST elevation. It's kind of a misnomer. And let me get your attention again. So the EKG shows a slight ST elevation. So what? Is it a heart attack? Well, it could be, but it could also be myocarditis, acute pericarditis, or it could be a previous heart attack with a persistent ST elevation. So still we don't have a diagnosis. So now we have the non-ST elevation myocardial infarction. So what does that mean? Usually it means that there's ST depression, or there's T wave inversion, or there's transient ST elevation. So basically I want to kind of explain why that is. So you have the epicardium, you have the myocardium, and you have the endocardium. Usually non-ST elevation MI or ST depression is going to mean that you don't have a transmural infarction. That means the whole wall isn't dead, but usually the endocardium has been infarcted or ischemic, or the endo and the myocardium, but never transmural. Now again, let me explain that with a little picture. Here's my heart. I have my negative lead. I have my positive lead. And I have a partial wall infarction right here. So I'd make that a little bit bigger. This part is infarcted. So now I have these leaking ions, but this time instead of leaking this way, all of them, the ones on the surface are having a net movement this way. And so you, instead of lowering the EKG, you actually can make it go higher than it normally would be, and whenever the thing depolarizes and goes back to normal, you get it looks like it's going lower than it would be. So here's your normal EKG, and then, let me move some things over, and then you get this EKG where everything is a little bit higher. And then, whenever it repolarizes, everything goes back to normal. But then so after a short time, though, the leaking ions bring it back up again. Okay, so you did your EKG. You didn't find an ST elevation. You didn't find an ST depression, a T wave inversion, or any other thing. So what do? The EKG is essentially normal. We don't call it normal. We call it non-diagnostic. I say we. I've never even looked at a real EKG. I'm a student, so the we is me and the turd in my pocket, I guess. So me, my turd, my opossum, we call it non-diagnostic EKG. So what do? At that point, you repeat the EKG every 20 minutes. So why is that? Well, because of math and science, right? So the specificity for an initial EKG is 0.95, 95%. The sensitivity of an initial EKG, however, is only 0.55. With serial EKGs, the specificity stays the same, but the sensitivity increases by about 13%. So you're going to redo it every 20 minutes. You're going to do these serial EKGs, but you're not just going to wait around until you find a positive EKG. While you're waiting, you're going to take some blood. So the three most common markers used modern times, troponin I, troponin T, and CKMB. And CKMB, this creatine kinase MB type, is actually going by the wayside because science. So troponin has a higher specificity and sensitivity than CKMB. So having a high troponin, usually you're looking for a troponin greater than 99th percentile, then it would typically represent an infarction. However, it doesn't always. If this is the first time the person's come in, they say, oh, I've had chest pain, but I also had chest pain 3 days ago. If it's the initial presentation, it could mean that up to 7 days ago they had a heart attack and now they have another one. Or up to 7 days ago they had a heart attack and now they're just having like a stable angina. So the point is the troponin stays high in your system for up to 7 days. So this is the one time when CKMB can actually be useful, is if CKMB and troponin are both high, that means that within at least the last 3 days, there was some kind of damage to the myocardial tissue, because CKMB only stays high for about 3 days. Now, CKMB used to be used to diagnose reinfarction. So, person comes in, they have an MI, troponin goes up, and then they come back a few days later, chest pain again. Well, troponin's going to still be high. So, if this is 4 days or greater than or equal to 4 days, then you would say, oh, the CKMB should be back down unless they had another infarction. So CKMB used to be used to diagnose reinfarction, but newer assays will detect reinfarction with a higher specificity and sensitivity when the troponin increases by 20%. So even though the troponin didn't go down, if it goes up by 20% or more, you're like, oh, it's a reinfarction. Okay, no big deal. Well, it is a big deal, but you don't need to do extra labs. Okay, so you did your EKG, no, nothing there, non-diagnostic. You did your biomarkers, it came back negative. So you got this chest pain, and its clinical presentation strongly suggests that there's some myocardial ischemia. So what do? You keep doing the EKGs, and you reevaluate the biomarkers at 6 to 9 hours, and then if that doesn't happen, then again at 12 to 24 hours. Now here's the deal, biomarkers. You can have biomarkers without an MI, which is crazy. We say, oh, troponin's high, must be an MI. But you can actually have high troponin without an MI. Anything that damages the cardiac tissue, so the heart, anything that damages the heart can cause the cells to leak out troponin, CKMB, and any other thing. So what can damage the heart? Well, heart failure, rapid atrial fibrillation, myocarditis, cardiotoxicity, some subendocardial wall stress, myopericarditis, sepsis, chronic kidney disease. I didn't really look into why that is. I just know that it is because I read it. Now, some of these are emergencies, some of them are not. But one other emergency thing that I want to point out is pulmonary embolism. So pulmonary embolism cause an increased workload on the right heart. So right heart overload will cause some stress in the wall and cause some of the tissue, the heart cells, to break and leak out troponin and CKMB. So you will get an emergency situation, but it won't be a heart attack, and you will have a positive lab. Okay, I really struggled with what to do first, electrophysiology of an ECG or the MI, and MI just won because it was more interesting. But so we shall move on. Imagine right here we have a negative lead, and imagine right here we have a positive lead. And so as there is no activity, we're going to get a flat line on our ECG. Now, as depolarization moves toward the positive lead, so anytime depolarization moves toward positive, then you get an upstroke in your EKG. So if I had a positive lead on this side, I would get this kind of a wave. If I have a positive lead on this side, I would get this kind of a wave. Now, once the depolarization is completely depolarized, you get a flat line, because only thing we're only measuring change in polarization. Once the change stops, we get a flat line again, and then we get the repolarization. So repolarization, if it were to move in the same direction as the depolarization, you would get a downward stroke. And whenever repolarization finished, you would get a flat line because we're only measuring the change in polarization. So on an EKG, why do we get so many upward lines? You get the P wave up. Sometimes you'll get a slight Q wave downward, and the R and the S will be slightly downward, and the T wave will be up. So for just two downwards, we got three up. So why is that? It's because in the heart, repolarization doesn't move the same way as depolarization. It actually tends to move the other direction. So follow with me, if you will. We get a start the SA node depolarizing, and then you get over here, and it's depolarizing a little bit more, kind of this direction, and then you get here, it's completely depolarized, and there's a little pause, right? So we got a little up, we got a full, it's finishing off its depolarization, so the change is getting slower, but it's still changing, and then finally the change is done, and then so you get this little pause. Then this starts to repolarize, but we're in the QRS finally, so the repolarization here is going to be hidden by this much larger QRS complex. So the QRS, we start usually, so just to explain the, well, I'll get into that in a second. We start getting this depolarization, and it happens, so we're kind of moving in this general direction, kind of down and to the right. Well, it's to the person's left, but to our right. And so we get this upward tick, and then it kind of flattens out. And then we get repolarization starting here and kind of moving up this way. And so you have this movement. So, like I said, depolarizing moving toward the positive node and repolarizing moving away from the positive node, both of those will cause an upward stroke. And we get that in the ventricles, both during the depolarization phase and in the repolarization phase, it's moving back the other way. So we would expect to get two upward arrows. Why do we get this? Sometimes when we're looking at it, you say you get the P wave, and then you get this small stroke downward on the Q. And so what causes this? Well, that's because initially all of the, so you got your AV node, and it sends down these bundle branches on the right, and it sends down bundle branches on the left. Well, it turns out that these left bundle branches are actually the ones that depolarize the interventricular septum, this middle piece right here. And so they start and they will depolarize it, and you'll get this, the first thing that gets depolarized is the interventricular septum, so you kind of get a charge moving this way, but only for a split second. So you start to see this downward stroke because you have charge moving away from your positive node. And then as time progresses, you get basically a net vector in this direction. So if our leads are negative right here, positive right here, then we could take this net vector. We can say, okay, how much of it is moving in the direction of my node? And it would be this much of it. So the size, the magnitude of our upward deflection would be about this magnitude. And if we had a negative lead here and a positive lead here, then the magnitude would be about this magnitude, so much bigger. Now, why do we get the S weight? So you have, again, P, Q, R, S, and T. So why is the S wave sometimes lower? It's because the timing. So as the very first thing that happened is you get the depolarization reaching the AV node. And then if you as you look at it, so of course the left atrium is going to be the next thing to depolarize. And then so at 0.16 you start getting depolarization in the interventricular septum. At 0.18 you start getting it down here at the apex. At 0.21 and at 0.23 you get it at the up here at this base. And so the base being depolarized is kind of moving away from our positive node and toward our negative node. And that's all in virtue in the direction the heart kind of lays a little bit diagonal inside the body. And then of course, just so I make sure that I don't forget to mention it, the T wave is you get repolarization kind of starting from over here and moving in this general direction. So repolarization would be still causing an upward deflection if it's moving away from the positive charge. Now let's talk about the leads. So you get a lead, you place on your right arm, your left leg, and sometimes it'll be like two leads on the left leg, and some diagrams put it as a lead on the right leg, and I haven't really been able to tease out which is the most correct. So these leads form six axes, and then you have your chest leads that form six more axes. And so this, from here to here, this is called, so you have a negative here and a positive here, this is called lead one. And then you get a lead from here to here, with this being positive, this would be lead two. And then lead three is from here to here. And so you can see if we were to take these arrows and kind of overlap them, we have this, this, and this. So these are the directions from which we can look at the heart's activity with these leads. And then you have these chest leads, which the chest leads make the lead on the chest is always going to be positive. So V1, V2, V3, V4, V5, and V6, these are all positive. And they basically use the back of the person as the negative lead. So these are all like going diagonally through this person's body. And so you get another plane in which you can look at the heart's electrical activity, basically from back to front. And so these different leads have different names. So for example, the first leads I spoke about are the bipolar limb leads, and these were the first ones to kind of ever be discovered. Then you have these ones called AVR, AVF, AVL. The AV stands for augmented voltage. It means basically in order to get that lead, you have to add a little bit of current to your EKG machine to amplify it enough to see it. And what that does is basically it takes, so let's take AVR for example. This lead and this lead are both combined to make a negative lead, and by combining them it puts the vector kind of right here. And so the vector to go to the positive charge is like this arrow. And so this one here is going to have, this is a negative, this is a negative, this is a positive. So when you take the sum of these vectors, it almost puts it right smack in the middle of the person, and the vector of the positive charge goes straight down. So this is why it's called unipolar, because you really don't have a true negative pole. You kind of have a sum vector of two different negative poles. And so the same with this one, negative there, and it ends up putting the negative vector right there, and your total positive vector is in that direction. So with the AV limb leads, you get to look at the heart like this, and like this. With the bipolar leads, you get straight across, and then you get down at an angle, and down at the other angle. So whenever you kind of cross these, you get 6 different ways in which you can view the heart in the frontal plane. Now, I went over this kind of a little bit a few minutes ago when I talked about the magnitude. So if all the electrical energy were moving directly from left to right, then our lead one would have a very high R wave. If all of the electrical energy were moving down at an angle, then we would only get this vector of the positive charge on our R wave, so a little bit smaller. And then if it were moving straight down, we would have no lateral vector, and so we would get a flat R wave on our lead one. And then if it were moving this way, we would actually get a negative, so this much, this small negative vector on lead one. And so the point of that is, with just lead one, I don't know if maybe the magnitude of the heart's electrical activity is going to be smaller here, or if it's just going in another direction. And it could be going this direction, or it could be going that direction. I don't know. So there's three possibilities for this smaller wave, and I don't know which one's correct. So I have to look at other directions of electrical activity. So for example, I could look at lead 2 and see that, oh, lead 2's got a really high R wave, so all of the energy is going in that direction, and that would kind of give me an idea of the direction of the electrical movement inside the heart. With this one, I would want to look at AVF. So AVF would be the highest in this, while lead 1 would be the lowest. And then with your chest leads, they're actually looking at the movement from back to front, so from the back of the body to the front of the body. And V1, V2 kind of are looking mostly at the right ventricle, V5, V6 over here kind of looking at the left ventricle, V3 and V4 looking primarily at apex and intraventricular septum. So now is the time where everyone who's in this lab can raise your hand and ask me questions.